So it's a way of predicting whether somebody's going to respond on a non-stimulant within 2 or 3 weeks. And what would be the precedent for even asking that question? There's an old study with Prozac that looked at 182 patients with MDD who were put on Prozac with a sustained acute response, 20 milligrams a day. And here's what they found. At 2 weeks, 55% who responded would continue to improve up to 50%. At 4 weeks, another 25% would improve. So within this, you could say, if you were put on Prozac and you don't see much of a response between 2 to 4 weeks, at the end of 4 weeks, if you don't see a response, you have two options. You can go up on the dose, or you can move on to another sequence. But that's the foundation for asking this question in ADHD and non-stimulants. So the study, several studies for atomoxetine, the 6 randomized controlled trials. They broke up the subjects into much improved, minimally improved, and non-responders. You'll notice, by the way, here, it's a 40-40, not yet. So 40%, 47% much improved, 40% didn't respond, 13%. I usually say a third, a third, a third. A third respond, a third can't tolerate it, and a third don't get better. No baseline characteristics predicted who was going to respond to a non-stimulant or atomoxetine versus they were going to respond. The only predictor of achieving this response was being at least minimally improved at week 4. So this gives you some idea. Again, you don't put them on atomoxetine and say, well, we'll wait 3 months and see if it works. At 4 weeks, if you've titrated them up and they're good, if you don't see much of an improvement at 4 weeks, you either need to go higher or you need to move on. So continuing on with this, you're going to see some statistics. So I want to give you the operational definitions. Sensitivity is the probability of a true responder. Specificity is the probability of a true non-responder. And positive predictive power gives you the probability that the patient selected by the model will respond at 6 weeks. So this gives you some statistical information as to whether or not your patient is or is not going to respond. This is a viloxazine study in children. There's 4 phase 3 trials. They put all the data together. The change, they used the change in the ADHDRS for the DSM-5 and the CGI-I score, which is clinical global impression improvement, were the best predictors of efficacy outcome. The change in the ADHDRS at week 2 could predict the response at week 6. So 75% positive predictive power. Interesting. And the model also required 4 weeks of treatment to make a prediction that achieved the level of accuracy similar to what was found in 2 weeks. So if you titrated appropriately on viloxazine, 2 to 3 weeks, if you're not getting a response, you need to make a change. You can't hang out for 2 months and say, well, let's just see what happens. This gives you some information as to when you move to the next sequence in your algorithm. And this is the results of adults, very similar. So single adult trial, response was defined as 50% reduction, 41% responded. Week 2 data was sufficient to accurately predict response at 6 weeks. Positive predictive value was 68. 3 week data was also similar in predicting the response at 6 weeks. Just trying to make the point here, there is some predictive merit to the amount of time and when you should consider moving on because the patient is not getting better. Now, if you want to boil this down, just so give you very hard, concrete numbers, if you take 100 patients, you put them on viloxazine, ER, 48 will respond at week 2, 33% will respond by week 6. Not as high as you'd like to see, but it gives you some information as to who's going to get better, who's not going to get better, and at what point in the treatment time point you move on with the next sequence.